I don't know what to say here, folks. You know, I always have a lot to say, and I'll have a lot to say here. Very intense. But what happened today has got me just, I don't even know what to say. I don't even know what word to use to describe it. I just have to lay it out for you. And it's ongoing. This is something that's quite extraordinary. The sequence of events that happened today is absolutely extraordinary. Couldn't even have hardly dreamt this, and yet it happened. And it started out all quite innocently, actually. It just without disclosing too much personal things about anyone, but it just so happened that, let's say, that I got this kind of invitation, like, hey, sometime let's go play golf, from somebody. And it kind of shocked me, because I don't play golf anymore. And this was an invitation to a real exclusive country club. And you know, and I was like, wow, I don't know. I was really kind of like jolted by this. I came out of the blue, I never expected it. I mean, never had that happen to me before in my life. So, I said, oh, yeah, well, sure, yeah. I said, uh-oh, I don't even know if I can play anymore. I've got so many infirmities that you know, kind of get in the way. So I went home, and I said, wow, what am I going to do? I was almost panicking. And suddenly it hit me. He said, you know, I got to just jump out on a golf course. Just get out right this minute and start, see if I can still play. I mean, I don't even know if I can play anymore, tell you the truth. And so, very hurriedly, I decided, I just got to do it. It was just, I mean, I'm not, usually not this way. I thought I'd given up golf, really. So, I made a reservation, and I just went after work. Okay, so I said, this is going to be a disaster, maybe. I don't know what's going to happen here. I don't even know if I can walk, swing, or anything. And so, okay, I get out on the first tee, and I got paired with another single. Okay. And the other single goes, I smell smoke. And I said, I smell smoke too. And then he says, I think there's a fire. And I said, I think there's a fire too. And then he looked up and said, he kind of said, I think there's a fire close by. And I said, I hope it's not close by, but it could be, yeah. And then I looked up and I said, hey, look at all that smoke. It's billowing over here. And I said, oh my gosh. And we said, you know what? There is a fire and it is close by. So. And then he says, I wonder if it's on the golf course. And I said, holy cow, I hope it's not on the golf course. What are we going to do if it's on the golf course? And the wind was blowing strongly. And I said, you know, it smells like a grass fire. And yeah. And then we look up and the smoke's getting heavier and heavier and billowing over the country club and the clubhouse, I mean. And suddenly I look up and there's a helicopter. I said, I bet you that helicopter is a spotter for the fire. And then another helicopter comes over. And then here comes this airplane. Looks like a World War II, some kind of warplane of World War II with red dots on it and everything, like a Zero or something. And this airplane is going around right where we are. We're standing on the tee. Say, hey, is it safe? I mean, are we safe? If we get out on the course, is there going to be some wildfire and engulf us or something? Wildfire and engulf? Get the word. Okay, so we were getting kind of nervous, and the smoke was getting heavier, and starting to breathe in the smoke. And I said, hey, this is kind of unexpected. And I'm saying, the irony of ironies, I've played maybe once or twice in the last 2 years, and I come out here on the first tee, and there's a wildfire on the course. I mean, what in the world's going on? I said, well, I get it. God is a setup. Right? He had this guy say, hey, invite me to play golf. And I said, oh, I can't, I'm not ready. So I jumped down on the course, and here's this wildfire now on the golf course. Now, here come the big planes. Big airplanes. Big airplanes, okay? And we say, holy cow, this is a big time fire. They're hitting it with everything they got. And so here come these airplanes. I guess they're dropping, you know, fire retardant on the fire. And we're looking up, and it's like, you know, the smoke, the airplanes, the wind, and it's just like, wow, very, very surreal. Very surreal. And then the planes, they're circling around, they keep coming back for more. And then this big airplane, this fire retardant airplane, it comes real low, flying right over the clubhouse. I mean, holy cow. I mean, could you imagine? I mean, to see a huge plane just flying right over, right near where you are. I mean, this was quite startling. Because they had to get real close to the fire, you know. So we're like saying, this is absolutely surreal what's going on here. And we said, oh, well, you know, we teed off and said, well, I asked him, I said, hey, do you think the fire can get us? And he says, nah, I don't think so. You know, I said, well, you know, maybe smoke inhalation might get us. And I was kind of nervous. So someone comes up to us. Okay. A marshal comes up on a golf cart. I says, hey, guys, there's a fire. Yeah, it's on the course. Wow. Okay, you'll never guess what hole it's on. And I didn't realize this till later. And he said, it's on hole 11, number 11. Now, I mentioned in the video previous to this yesterday that I made this Ramana Maharshi video, Silence is Also Conversation, and I posted it and clicked on it to watch it, and I just noticed, just somehow caught my attention, which I normally doesn't, but and the length of the video is 9/11. And of course, we're coming up on the double jubilee of 9/11, 2001. Every 7 years you call it a jubilee. Well, this will be then the double jubilee of 9/11. Very significant. Now, there's even more. So I'm playing golf in this surreal situation where the smoke is billowing up in the air, and we realize there's a fire raging on the golf course, and we're still playing, and the guy says, hey guys, you're gonna have to skip the 11th hole. You're gonna have to skip it. You have to go around to the 12th. Can't play the 11th. There's a fire. Interesting. You'll have to skip the 11th. So I'm going around and I'm playing, I guess, okay, and my body's hurting in some ways, but I'm still managing to play decently. I was pretty surprised. But there's a song going through my head. Song going through my head while this is all happening. And songs tend to reveal something within us. Sometimes they're very prophetic. And of course, the song that I was listening, not of course, I mean, the song that I was singing over and over was Walking in the Rain by the Ronettes, produced by Phil Spector, which I've been listening to recently a couple times. I don't know why. And the part of the song that I was saying over and over and over, singing it, was that part. And sometimes we'll fight, sometimes we'll fight, and sometimes we'll fight. You know, walking in the rain. Meanwhile, there's all these airplanes like World War II is going on overhead. Sometimes we'll fight. The 11th hole, it's September, and the 11th hole is on fire. Double jubilee of 9/11. So there's a lot of heavy, heavy symbology here. I mean, what are the odds that I would find myself right in that situation? It never crossed my mind that I would be going there and playing golf. You know, it was a chain of events. A very, very odd chain of events, because I was not in the slightest bit was thinking I'd be invited to play golf by this person. It never crossed my mind, actually. I was quite taken aback by it. Who am me? I'm just a peon, you know. But I was thinking about this today, switching gears a little bit as we think about let this 9/11 thing marinate. Is something going to happen on 9/11? The cart guy says you need to skip the 11th hole. Go around it. Wow. So today I'm working and I'm such a, and I started saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, I mean, for me to the idea that the me just as this absolute no status peon would be playing golf with some, you know, absolute, you know, what would you say? elite, so to speak, very, very high up there, sort of a real pillar of the community, you might say. I say pillar of the community, as I say this, but that's ridiculous, you know. It's ridiculous. But then I thought about something. And if I was asked, well, what do you do? I mean, what do you do? And you know what I'd say? I'd say I'm in management. I'm in management. And they might say, well, you know, what kind of management? I'd say, well, the very top kind of management, actually. Managing the spiritual path to eternal life. And I'd say, you know what? I'm one of the best managers in the world, because the spiritual path is the most difficult situation to manage there is. It makes like managing GM look like a picnic, you know, really. It's that difficult. And so I've been able to excel at managing the path, the spiritual path. So I'm a super manager. I'm in management, and I'm very, very elite in terms of managing the spiritual path. So I looked at it that way, and I said, "Wow, I'm not maybe I'm not just some peon actually, because I'm like some super accomplished person." So I sort of flipped the whole script. I've always thought in my life I'm just nothing. And I can't hang out with anybody who has any status because I don't have any. What have I accomplished in the world? Well, actually, I'm super accomplished. I just the Holy Spirit just pointed this out to me. He said, "Hey, what are you feeling so inferior for? You're super accomplished, actually." And I just kind of thought about it. I said, "Well, you know, you're kind of right about that." Wow. And then another thing I realized that I have a super high status because I'm poor. I've been very poor my whole life. And this has been a great blessing. Not very few are blessed to be very poor and yet still not be homeless. Okay? Somehow miraculously I've escaped homelessness. And am well taken care of still. This is a supreme blessing from God, actually. I realized this. Holy Spirit pointed out to me, you're supremely blessed. Very few people are this blessed. Because it's given me the opportunity to give enormous effort towards how to manage the spiritual path, which is the highest, most difficult form of management there is in the world. And this is why I have this budding friendships with these various great teachers like Jesus, Ramana Maharshi, Longchenpa, etc. Because, you know, they're experts at this type of management. And so obviously they're going to be aware of those who are coming up in the ranks and working on how to manage the spiritual path. They're going to be very much aware of them, very much so. And so I realized, hey, I'm not like some, you know, complete, totally unaccomplished. It's exactly the opposite. Exactly the opposite. I'm super accomplished. I said, wow. You know? And to be poor is an extreme blessing. I guarantee you, if I had been rich this lifetime, I would have gotten into a lot of trouble. I never would have been where I am now. There's no way in the world. No way in the world. Being super poor, I can't do anything. All I can do here is sit and contemplate my whole life. All I can do is work on the management, learning the management skill, how to manage the spiritual path, how to manage spiritual success. That's all I could do. Because I couldn't do anything else, really. I can't take a vacation, you know. I can't go to a concert. I can't do this. Occasionally I play golf at real super discount rates. But even then, I don't have the, you know, it's all the money I have in the world. And So I just have to just sit here and tape and read and study and pray and contemplate and practice. That's it. But what a blessing that is. What an ultimate blessing that is. It's a supreme blessing to be super poor and yet still be in comfortable circumstances, which has been my situation. I've really lived in the best place in the world, really. I mean, most people, world travelers come here and they say, this is the best place in the world, no question about it. I spent my whole life in the best place in the world, been extremely poor but in comfortable circumstances, learned how to manage the spiritual path and have become very accomplished in it. So you have this enormous success story, actually. And I never even seen it that way. But, you know, if I can hold my head up, maybe I can, you know, hold my head up. So, anyway, I was able to play golf pretty doggone well. And, in fact, I got better and better. And I actually played better than years ago when I last was playing. I'm actually better now. I've not even played at all. And I was actually better. I don't know how that's possible, but it's true. I was knocking down the pin. I was hitting it down the middle, knocking down the pin. I don't know, wasn't putting very well, but that's something you have to, you know, practice a little bit, get your touch. But I mean, I was playing great. I don't know how that's possible. Maybe all the bad thoughts are out of my head. You know, all the scar tissue has healed. That's my technique. The way to get good at golf is just don't play. And it's true, because for me, the more I play, the worse I get. For some weird reason, I don't know. But I'm sure I'll feel it tomorrow morning. My body is probably just going to be just devastated by it, because I'm so completely out of shape. Terribly, terribly out of shape. So 9/11 Is something going to happen in 9/11? Well, it certainly seems that the Holy Spirit's getting my attention. It looked like a war scene there. And I've had these dreams of this desert storm, this horrible desert storm, which refers to a war situation. Fire, smoke, war planes, and I'm singing this song, and sometimes we fight. And sometimes we fight. Wow. And I said that September is just postpone your reaction to whatever happens in September to October. This is what I've been reiterating. Postpone your reaction to whatever happens in September to October. Don't react. So something, I believe, is going to happen. I don't know what. I haven't had any dreams that specifically point anything out. I don't have any dates. Some people say the 23rd, 24th of September, you know, is some very, very strong setup. It's the Day of Atonement, Jewish Day of Atonement. So something to consider in, you know, where are you going to be this double Jubilee? 9/11, they said, can't play the 11th hole, got to skip it. It's unplayable. It's unplayable. The 11th is unplayable. I don't know. So, we will see what else, what God will do next. Also, there's someone I was playing with, he said, yeah, I lost my job a while ago, and now, but I'm going to get a new one in 3 weeks' time, and I'm trying to get in shape for that. And like I had felt before I went to the course, I said, I need to get in shape for about 3 weeks. This is what I thought, too. I need to start working out and getting in shape real fast. Real fast. This is really important. And here this guy I'm playing with says, wow. You know, that he's working out all the time, getting in shape. He says, yeah, I think I'm going to have a new job starting in 3 weeks. A new job starting in 3 weeks. Now, it gets even stranger. Yesterday, I was just sort of daydreaming about golf. I don't know why. And I happened to daydream about this hole, this golf hole that I'd seen years ago, with all these big rocks, and I hit the ball into these rocks, and it bounced off the rocks. I was playing off the rocks, for some reason, some weird reason. And then it has to have some, well, maybe I better not correlate it too much, but let's just say, and today I hit this ball that hit the wall. There's this huge rock wall. I hit the wall, and the ball bounced, hit it and bounced, and it ended up right in the middle of the fairway. It's like, what's going on here? A lot of stuff that happened today. It was very surreal, very surreal. Let's just say that my daydream about playing golf and hitting these rocks has something to do with the whole situation, that there's some confirmations going on, that this is not just idle daydreaming. This is not, there's a complex here. An entire complex has suddenly emerged here that is a super attention getter. Super attention getter. Hitting the wall. My playing partner said, "Oh, looks like your ball's lost." I said, "Well, that's too bad." And then suddenly he says, wait a minute. What's that down there? Is that a ball?" And it was like way down there, right in the middle of the fairway. Unbelievable how it could have bounced like that and been right in the middle of the fairway. I just like, okay, today's my day. So there's a super powerful spiritual awakening taking place right now, an apocalypse, a super powerful apocalypse taking place right now. And it seems as though something is emerging here. 9/11 is emerging, September is emerging. And my intuition is I stop watching the news entirely to get ready, to get used to that ahead of time. It means I feel there's something going to happen that we don't want to pay attention to in the news. We don't want to get hooked into it. Stay away from it. Stay away from it. Something very powerful is coming. And so if you're already used to not watching the news, you're in good shape because you just stay away from it. I mean, you'll hear about it from people, but you just say, well, I'm not going to look at any coverage of it at all, because you'll be super saturated coverage that just absolutely will bring you into freak out mode, which is what they want, which is what the ego wants. And those who believe that the ego is the best advisor there is. Now, I'm driving today to work, and suddenly this arises in me like this. This is how the ego operates. It says that the ego says, refuse to acknowledge the continuity problem. Don't work on it. Oh, here it was. The ego says, oh yeah, okay. Yeah, maybe there is a continuity problem, but there's an excuse. The ego's the great excuse maker. It really is the great excuse maker. The ego's really just a voice expression of our continuity fear. That's all it is. And this continuity fear gives rise to all these excuses why we can't work on our continuity fear to evaporate today, not right now, but maybe later, but not now. So the ego will say, well, maybe tomorrow we'll work on it. Yeah, tomorrow. I have to do something right now. It's an excuse. Whereas we use the same similar technique to block the ego. Say, not now, ego, maybe later. What the ego uses this to, see, we're very familiar with this technique. The ego says, well, I'm not working on the continuity fear right now because I got a party today. I got to go to a friend's house, or I got to work. I have this appointment, or I'm feeling tired. I'm sick. And it makes infinite excuses for us. And so we never do it. Most people never, a day in their life, ever focus on evaporating the continuity problem. It simply doesn't happen. Very, very few actually work on it. It's quite a pity. It's very much of a pity here in this world that this is the case. And people just waste their lives. They don't really ever get around to doing anything of any consequence here at all, of any importance whatsoever. the great teachers tell us our sole responsibility is the spiritual path. And if you avoid that, you're just wasting your life. You're not doing anything of any importance whatsoever. And I believe this is true. So the ego gets us excuse, and we just don't do it. We think, well, I'll do it tomorrow. And then there's another excuse tomorrow. So then the ego takes a different tact. It can take a different tact. And then the ego will say, hey, you know, this continuity thing, I don't think it exists. And it will say, why? And said, well, the ego will say, well, if it really existed, if it really was this terrible problem, the ego says, don't you think you would have been working on it? For sure you would have been working on it? And we say, oh yeah, of course. If it really existed, of course I would have been working on it. It'd be crazy not to. Then the ego says, well, it must not exist then. And that's its end game, is to get us to believe it doesn't exist. And then we remain trapped. So first the ego makes excuses not to work on it. Every time it comes up, it makes excuses, always. And then it plays this tricky end game of saying, well, guess what? You know, there really isn't any. I got news for you. There isn't any continuity problem. It doesn't exist. And we say, well, why say that? He said, well, if there was, and it was so severe and so important, don't you think you would have been working on it? And you haven't worked on it your entire life, right? And we say, yeah, that's right. And the ego says, well, it must not exist then, right? And we say, yeah, that makes sense. Makes sense? This is the trickiness of the ego. But see, it's advising us first not to work on it at all, and then claims the fact we're not working on it means it doesn't exist. Very clever. Very clever. But you'd expect us to be clever, and it's our own fear that is responsible for the ego advice we're getting. So it's quite difficult to work on the continuity problem because the ego keeps playing this game that says, well, you know, if there really was one, wouldn't you have been working on it already? I mean, right? You know, we say, well, yeah, I'd be stupid not to. I'm not stupid, therefore it must not exist at all. And then the ego can double down on denial of it, and then you really go down into darkness. So I had a good laugh at that, just the absurdity of the ego, thinking that you know, that we're supposed to accept such utterly whimsical logic like that. Yeah, but it seems logical to us. So yeah, sure, that seems logical. Hey, today even my bad shots were good. I hit one thin, it went screaming into the bunker, and it was going so fast it hit the lip of the bunker and flew way up in the air and out of the bunker and landed in the fringe and then rolled and ended up like, you know, 5-6 feet away from the hole. It was ridiculous. If it hadn't hit the bunker, it would have been lost, gone flying over the green, lost, you know. It was ridiculous. Everything was just working out, you know, miraculously today. So we have this severe continuity problem, and very few actually work on evaporating it, because the ego's fundamental purpose is to keep us from recognizing we have a severe continuity problem. Because once we realize we have it, then we realize we can set it down. It's ours. It's not that the world is attacking us or anything. It's that we have this problem. Now, if the world was attacking us and all this stuff, then we have to fight off everything. It's so difficult. But if we have a problem that's our problem, we can work on it and resolve it, and then we don't have it anymore. Right? So it's easy. As Ramana said, don't try to remove all the thorns and pebbles from the world. Just wear shoes. Where the ego tells us to go, you know, go barefoot and try to remove all the bumps and bruises, anything, you know, sweep the world clean so we can go barefoot. And Ramana says, hey, just put on a pair of shoes and you're good to go. It's that simple. And of course the ego never advises that. And of course, the eagles say, well, don't you think if there was such a thing as shoes, you would already be wearing them? I mean, are you really that stupid? You go through life, you know, sweeping the world clean, going barefoot. If there really was such a thing as shoes, don't you think you would have been using them before and it saved you all this trouble? And you think, oh, yeah, of course I would have. That would be stupid. If there was shoes, it's very stupid for me to not wear them, you know? So we conclude, well, there must not be anything like shoes. It's ridiculous. You see how our pride, our arrogance, our fear, all this, how this blinds us to the truth, to the simplicity. Because the ego says, no, if there really was truth, you would have realized it, bud. You would have realized it. You would have known it, right? And we say, oh, yeah, of course I would. And then it says, well, it must not be. It just must be a myth. If eternal life was true, why wouldn't you be aware of it by now? I mean, come on, that's important. And we say, no, I'm not aware of it. Well, then it must not exist, the ego says. See, we deceive ourselves. So I was out in the golf course and it was hitting it pretty good, but it still, there was some issues, you know. I said, what can I do? And then I made this little adjustment that I had thought about in the months previous to just tinkering a little bit and just, not on the course, but just practicing the swings here. And I tried it and it worked fabulously, just fabulous. I said, uh-oh. And I started just, you know, drilling the ball right at the pin and just sticking it. I was just like, uh-oh, what's this? You know, it's just, wow. So a little adjustment can make a huge difference on the golf course. And in life, it's the same way. A little adjustment, seeing through the ego's game. Just a little seeing. Say, let me just try this. Let me try this practice. Let me try this. You know, keep trying, keep tinkering. And I have a different stance, everything, and it works great. And my playing partner at the end said, hey, you know what? Stick with it. It's working great for you. So he said, stick with it. It's working great for you. And I said, yeah, I think I will. And this is a metaphor for life, the spiritual path. Stick with it. It's working great for me. And it certainly is. And keep in mind that seeing that nothing makes an impression upon God, that seeing, that realization, that too does not make an impression upon God. Very important. And this might be a little adjustment that we need, and this may be all that we need. I made this one simple little adjustment, just tilted the club more upright, just slightly tilted it, and suddenly the shots are going dead straight. I said, wow, that works, really works. So our little adjustment maybe in life, spiritual path, might be, hey, our recognition, our seeing that God is both shining as everything and remaining as nothing, and seeing that nothing makes an impact on God, nothing makes an impression on God at all. Seeing that extraordinary realization, oh my gosh, this is eternal life. Seeing that does not make an impression upon God. But we assume that it does because thoughts impress other thoughts. And that's what the purpose of thoughts is, to be impressed and reacted upon. Thoughts are reacted upon and they're reactive. And we symbolize, our thinking symbolizes impressions and impactfulness, that we believe that we can impact God and make an impression upon God. So we have these imaginary thoughts that are impressed by other thoughts and situations. So when we see, you know, that nothing impresses God, nothing makes an impact on God, that makes a huge impact on our thoughts. And then we might take that to mean that this is making an impact on God. But it is not. It is not. So seeing this little adjustment here, that enlightenment does not make an impact on God at all. Are seeing that nothing impacts God, that in itself does not impact God. But it may impact our thoughts extraordinarily. Might be, you know, we're shocked, we're stunned. Oh my gosh, all these thoughts, I don't need them. It's all a game I've been playing of trying to believe that God can be impacted by all this, these thoughts impacting one another. This is this mental suffering complex that we have. You know, I don't need it anymore. I don't need it. very important. So realizing that we don't need the egoic self, that doesn't shock, doesn't make an impression on God at all. Realize that, you know, I am God, doesn't make an impression upon God. God remains shining as everything and remaining as nothing. God is shining as everything, remaining as nothing. No thing. So you might have a good, decent game, like I was having a decent game, as you know, I was playing decently, and some stuff was wayward. But I made a little adjustment, and then there was also a slight, the angle of the club angle. I did a slight adjustment of the swing path, just slight adjustment, and suddenly everything clicked into place. And I was just hammering the ball, you know, deep. Dead straight, just hammering it. And it's like, wow, that little adjustment had a huge difference. Now, but having a huge difference, let's say spiritually, wow, I see that God, you know, is all this is not making any impression on God. This whole universe, no impression, nothing makes an impression. God shining as everything, remaining as nothing. And we think, oh, this is making such a huge impression. No, it's not. It's not. But I'm abiding in God now. Doesn't that impress, make an impression upon God? No, it doesn't. See, this is this extraordinary little adjustment we need to make. How many days to next Friday? Well, it's 9/11. It's Jubilee is a week away. Just a week away. Oh, you know what? I was also listening to a song last night. The Holy Spirit said, I want you to listen to a song. I said, what's that? Well, you can't always get what you want. I haven't listened to that song in ages by the Rolling Stones. I was standing in line with Mr. Jimmy, you know, drug in the corner drugstore. Why am I listening to that? You can't always get what you want, but try sometimes. You just might find you get what you need. I don't know. But then I saw someone's list of their favorite Rolling Stones songs. I was actually a Rolling Stones fan back in the 60s, before Altamont. You know, Altamont kind of really soured the 60s for a lot of people. That and some other stuff that happened. And the Stones got sort of a reputation as they're playing Sympathy for the Devil at the concert, and it triggered a lot of mayhem and stuff. And I said, that's not cool, you know, that's enough of that. They had a bad boy image, you know, that kind of got out of hand there. But really in the 60s, the Stones were just extraordinarily successful. It was the Beatles and the Stones. And so I listened to this other song, and bringing back memories. Give me shelter. Wow. And you know, they say, hey, something, it's just a shout away. It's just a shout away. What's just a shout away? Give me shelter. It's just a shout away. It's just a shout away. What shout means it's close. It's very close by. Just a shout away. So, uh-oh, these songs are saying something. Oh, children, you know, it's just a shout away. It's just the various things they're saying. But the idea, I said, what am I doing listening to Rolling Stones? That's super odd for me right now. Very odd. Give me shelter. It's just a shout away. So, like I have been saying, we're in this year phase from June 22nd through to next June 22nd, 2016. is extraordinarily apocalyptic time. And we have prepared for this. So we're now into it. We're into it. Into what we have prepared for. And just the Holy Spirit flipping my whole self-esteem issue, flipping it and saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, what are you saying that you're have no accomplishment in life whatsoever? What are you talking about? Because you got to have the highest kind of accomplishment, you know, becoming a near expert, closing in on being an expert. About the entire spiritual path and understanding the whole situation and having a complete overview of it and knowing how to manage your success and on and on and on. Says this is the key management skill. So, you know, look at yourself that way. Don't walk around with your head down. You're not a nobody at all. Valuable commodity. I said, I didn't just waste my life. You mean actually this is helpful? Yeah. Holy Spirit says, yeah, are you kidding? I don't allow myself to think that way. You know, I don't allow myself to pat myself on the back. It's just every day is just a grind, you know. You just keep working and working and working and don't think about it. But there's something about being super lowly and poor in life with no status that enables one to gain this higher status. Because if you have any status in this world and money, you're going to be working to try and multiply it. Okay? You'll get caught up in the rat race. But in my case, no health, no status, no money. I can't even get even a toehold in the status of the world. So I said, why even try? I'm not going to even try. It's useless. It's futile. Nothing I do works anyway, so all I do is then work on the spiritual path. That's it. So it's a great, great, great blessing that's happened, actually. In order to gain the higher status, you have to forego the lower status of you know, worldly, mortal mind status. In order to attain to the realization, acceptance of eternal mind as the only mind there is, you need to forego the pursuing mortal mind status, which is what has happened to me. By design, I guess, by the grace of God. So, I'm... So that explains it. In order to attain this higher status, it's beneficial to have a super low, invisible status, really. Can't even see you. Nobody can even notice you, which has been my life, which was so extraordinary. Somebody noticed me today, said, hey, you know, you should come play golf with me. Whoever says that to me, I'm invisible to the world. So somehow, my status is somehow rising right now. Okay, this is the apocalyptic times, whereas the veil is coming off of everybody here. And so in some way, somehow, my status is now being unveiled, you know. Whereas I can't, you know, maybe hide forever as just this complete failure here. Total failure to be completely ignored, which has been so beneficial. Nobody bugs you because you don't have anything to offer. So nobody invites you anywhere. Nobody asks you any questions. Why should I ask him a question? He doesn't know anything. He has no status. Why? He can't tell me anything about how to succeed. Obviously, he has no success. How can he tell me anything about how to succeed? So everybody just left me alone. And then I was able to, you know, just make hay while the sun was shining. And now here comes the rain. The latter day rain. Latter rain. And it was, again, playing golf was very strange. I was playing, the player I was with was very, very good. It was really, I was like, wow. But as things went on, I started hitting better shots. And he was a very great guy, and he's just saying, "Wow, what a great shot you just hit!" That's just a tap in there. It's like extraordinary, and I kept hitting these really, really extraordinarily great shots. It's ridiculous. I never hit the ball so well. And so somehow my status is being revealed. The veil is lifting. And it turns out maybe I do have some sort of status. It's just kind of a shock to me. What can I say? What can I do? You know, it's the apocalypse. I'm used to, being a nobody. It feels kind of comfortable most of the time, actually. But that may not last. It may not last. And I'm getting ready for that. Obviously, I'm getting ready for it. The Holy Spirit's flipping the script, saying, "Wait a minute. What do you mean that you have no accomplishment? You're like top level management skill. Make the people at Google look silly, or whatever. You know, as far as their management talents and skills, and piece of cake compared to the spiritual path. All that stuff of the world is a piece of cake." Just, lazy, taking it easy, actually. Well, the spiritual path is very intense. It requires tremendous determination and discipline and patience and stick-to-itiveness and just every last shred of management you can possibly find to keep some sort of balance and even keel and keep your momentum and stop from falling into all these traps that the ego lays out for us, and to just not get too down. I was very down this morning, but I just had to, you have to battle through it, because it's extraordinary. You feel like there's no purpose for living anymore. I've not done anything. You have to battle through the shock of the wow, manage this is so intense, so requiring so much dedication to it. So the Holy Spirit just gave me a pat on the back today. It says, "Hey, maybe this time your status is going to be revealed." And yeah, okay. It helps. It really helps a lot. I mean, I never thought of it that way. I'm just getting used to this. I'm trying to, kind of wrap my mind around a little bit and think about it like that. For me, it's like I'm a failure, I can't succeed, it's so difficult. but success doesn't come without developing all the management skills that are needed. And so now I realize that success is, it's very close, I know that. But so you don't get that close, without having to have superb management skills, it's not possible. So I guess I have developed that. When you compare it to, someone like Jesus or Ramana Maharshi or Longchenpa or someone else, it's just like, I don't know anything. I'm a complete idiot. but that's relative. That's relative. I mean, they have like this uber management skills. I cannot even, hardly fathom it. How they're able, they deal with just like the entire spectrum, the whole situation is quite extraordinary. I have just some faint, maybe, saying like, but just very faint, like, just quite extraordinary what they're able to do. Just a shout away. Sometimes we fight. Whatever it is, I'll tell you this, whatever it is, the Holy Spirit knows what's coming, whatever it is. Okay, there's no question about it. I can feel it. I can feel the Holy Spirit is letting us know, giving us clues, giving us hints, guiding our lives, helping us out. Without appearing to be intrusive in any way. You know, the Holy Spirit says, like, leaves no footprints. Sometimes we fight. Yeah, that relates to the world, doesn't it? Sometimes we fight, like World War I or World War II. I thought I was in a war zone today. And of all the places on the planet, the Holy Spirit had me right in that place. But yet I was safe. But still, just close by was this war zone. It was feeling like a war zone. But I didn't have to witness any of the fire. We were over the hill, just over the other side of the hill from it. So interesting, right? Sidestepped it somehow. Sidestepped it. So, all praise to the Holy Spirit. How it works is unfathomable to us, really. We just have to keep having faith in it. And that it, you know, it's looking out after us, and it wants nothing more than for us to realize that we're eternal life. Eternal life is the only life there is, plain and simple. And to get free of the self-deception we call the ego, which is really just our continuity fear. It's not even our arrogance anymore, it's our continuity fear. Because even if we drop our arrogance and say, yeah, I really want to repent and wake up, the continuity fear is still in control. It says, no, if you do that, you won't have any functionality. You can't do that. Gotta delay. And what do? When we delay, oftentimes, if we're really in, you know, really want to wake up, then our continuity fear will say, well, gotta delay, but I'll tell you what, you can do, spiritualize the mortal mind. Work on spiritualizing the mortal mind, spiritualizing the world. And this is the huge mistake we make. This is egoic. Most of what goes on in the world for spirituality is really just trying to spiritualize the world. That's the ego. That's the ego. We don't need to spiritualize ourselves. We already are eternal life right now. We just need to realize this. We don't need to spiritualize it. We don't need to spiritualize anything, really. Certainly not the world. Certainly not the world. Certainly not mortal mind. We don't need to spiritualize, try to spiritualize mortal mind. That is the great mistake that we make and have continued to make over and over and over throughout the millenniums, however long we've been around. Pleistocene or something, Pleistocene, Holocene, a couple million years we've been around, hominoids, or I'm not kicking it back at 10 million recently, but as far as Homo sapiens has been around, I don't know, 100,000 years or more than that. Homo sapiens came out of Africa maybe 100,000 years ago. But there were Neanderthals, various other hominid groups at that time. So, however long, and it's more than that, it's the whole dream, however long the dream has been around. It's just we've been trying to spiritualize mortal mind, which is only a pretense of eternal mind. It's never coming from some other causative agent at all. Mortal mind is just a pretend causal agent of this idea of mortality, impermanence of mortality. The spirit is pretending that it's not spirit. Eternal life is pretending that it's not eternal life. having trouble sleeping. The tension yesterday was off the charts. So, don't know specifically, but the Holy Spirit indicates like a war zone suddenly breaking out. I mean, where did that wildfire come from? Who knows? Maybe somebody's barbecue or cigarette. Doesn't take much. When you have dry grass, it doesn't take much to start a wildfire. In fact, I was told that somebody in Los Angeles hit a rock with their golf club, and the rock had some flint in it or something. It sparked, caused a spark, and that spark caught the grass on fire, and there was a terrible wildfire down in Los Angeles causing a lot of destruction from a golf club striking a rock, you see. So when the tinder is dry, it takes very little to start a conflict. Apropos of that, let's say there's a lot of people in there, they're tired, very tired and angry and irritated, and they drink a whole bunch of caffeine or energy drugs, whatever, and they're wired too, and they can become super belligerent, you know. And in that sort of situation, people are on edge. It takes very little to start a bar fight. Very little to start a bar fight. Just the slightest trigger. You're like, hey, why did you do that? Do what? You bang the door, or you did something, or you, whatever it takes. And before you know it, you know, everybody is like just ferociously angry. Well, the world is like that right now. So it doesn't take much to spark a global wildfire in terms of conflict, because people are very much on edge, apparently. Whereas if everyone's relaxed and mellow and calm and everything, it takes a lot to get them riled up. I mean, some people, you just cannot rile them up. They're so good-natured, you know, it just can't happen. Good-humored, good-natured. And when this is predominating, the good humor, good-natured, you know, positive, glass-half-fullness, it's very difficult to stir up anything. But we're not at that situation. We're in a situation where everyone's on edge. I don't know. A lot of different causes, right? I don't know what the stock market's doing and politics and global geopolitics. I don't know what's going on at all. I stopped. Stop. It's been, I guess it's been a week. A lot can happen in a week, but I don't know what's going on really. And don't really want to know. Maybe it's time to just go golfing. You know, it just is a symbol for something. It's don't take the world serious anymore, you know. Time to disengage from trying to accomplish something worldly, you know, from mortal mind, trying to aggrandize mortal mind, trying to spiritualize mortal mind. Yeah, it's time to just step away from all that. Because sometimes we fight. Sometimes this world fights. Sometimes this world fights. Okay, so the little tip that the realization of God, that nothing impacts God, does not impact God, because if we think it will impact God, we'll avoid it, won't we? Isn't that the reason why we're avoiding it? You say, oh my gosh, I don't want to impact God, I don't want anything to impact God, and I realize nothing impacts God. But if I realize that nothing impacts God, I'm afraid that will impact God, because it's so, what God will say, oh my gosh, that's great, I'm so impacted by that. And so we avoid it. We're afraid to wake up, thinking that waking up God will be impacted by our waking up from the delusion that God can be impacted. So this little tip like this just may tip the balance for us. So, that's enough for now. Run about an hour here. See what the Holy Spirit will do in your life right now. See, and we'll see what. Of course, I'll find out what the Holy Spirit will do for me, and pass it on. However, that you know may turn out. Okay. Very great, and we'll see you next time.